Thank you. Thank you, Deborah, for that creative introduction. For those of you watching this at home on YouTube, you just missed a great one. Okay, so yes, thank you. Welcome to coming to the event space. And this is a new presentation, and I'm very happy to give this one. We gave it once before, so this is the, it's been tested, and now it's ready for full public consumption. And I'm kind of happy with this one, because for me it's fairly important, because I like to photograph. I'm a photographer, I shoot constantly, and I do specialize in portraiture, but I also like to travel. So I do have a little bit of a slant towards portraiture and travel, capturing the local people, but most importantly, I like to go places, and I like to go there and be free of having large amounts of camera gear with me. There is a regular here that's in the audience, and she's known for bringing rolling backpacks and really traveling heavy, and I've always said, Carol, it's so heavy, you're killing yourself with all this equipment. But she was steadfast and very tough and would always carry the equipment. I do see today, though, you've got a smaller camera bag that you just bought. So there is something to be said about editing your gear when you get out there. The other reason I came up with this presentation, I had done with the Morbid Anatomy Museum in Gowanus, Brooklyn, which is just now a full museum. They offered a tour. It was called a Day of the Dead field trip, and it traveled to several cities in Mexico over Day of the Dead, which is a Mexican holiday on November 2nd. And I brought this a kit of equipment, which I'm going to show you the camera bag. And it was traveling super light. And as I went through on this trip, I was super happy with the images I was making. Everything was great, but I was traveling really light. And I think that's what really made it so incredible. So I played around with this equipment and kind of came up with this presentation based off of that trip. And I had been taking other trips and had been leading up to this trip, but this trip was very serious to get the right way. So first, clearly I want to talk about what is our mission today? What are we looking to accomplish? Well, the first thing is travel light and be nimble so we can get good shots all day long. Now, what I mean by that is that if you're up bright and early and you're going, you're making your photographs, then you get yourself breakfast, you're making some more photographs, you visit a museum, you visit a landmark or two, you have lunch, you're like really pooped out in the afternoon. That's not good. You got to keep shooting. You want to not kill your back by having a large camera bag. And also, if you're going into an area that is a little questionable, you want to fit in really well and not be, have that big red arrow saying, tourist, tourist, tourist. Our trip to Mexico, these were inner Mexico cities. It was Guanajuato, Monterrey, Zacatecas, and Aguascalientes. This wasn't Cabo, a very safe resort on the side. It was deep in, so I want to be kind of discreet as well. But mainly you want to keep shooting all day long and not hurt yourself. You want to enjoy where you go and not be encumbered. That is like the major consideration here. Also, when you travel very light, you're not as much of a target. You're not leaving things in trunks of cars. I'd done that in Italy a couple of years ago. I had a Hasselblad medium format system and a vintage rangefinder system. And I left all the Hasselblad stuff in the car, and I went and we photographed in Pisa. And I came back, and I remember sitting in the car, and I was like, something's different. I didn't leave the car this way. And sure enough, the car got broken into. They stole some change that was in the side thing. And I was like, the Hasselblad gear. And I quick got up and went to the trunk, and the camera bags had all been rifled through, but they didn't take anything. So it was really lucky. I think they were looking for change or money, something fast. A heavy medium format camera in 2006 didn't mean much to them, so they didn't steal it. But boy, that was a close one. So you know, you want to carry a little bit of gear, and if you have it with you over your shoulder, you know it's not going to get stolen. If you leave it in the hotel rooms or in cars or in buses, you can get into trouble. The other one is that really, what is travel photography? Make great images of where we go so that you can remember them. You can be proud of those images. As I was working on this last trip, I was editing the photos as I was going along with the iPad and Snapseed, and it really got me into the photograph better to be working and editing on the photograph as opposed to coming back and like for the next several weeks going through gigabytes and gigabytes of images on your computer on using Lightroom and trying to see what you got. So that's really, that's important. Go capture them and be inspired. And I want to also bring up spirit of place. You can't talk about travel photography without evoking spirit of place. Spirit of place is what National Geographic magazine is all about, and it's not just taking pictures, it's taking photographs that really indicate where you are and what the condition of the place is. So why do I advocate mirrorless cameras? Well, mirrorless cameras are compact for travel. That's wonderful. Now, a mirrorless camera doesn't have the hump that an SLR has. That hump that's on an SLR, that's the pentaprism. That's what the whole device that lets what you see through the lens going up into the prism and smooshing it around makes the camera much larger and much heavier. So mirrorless cameras are compact for travel. Now, they're also great performers now. We're probably in about, I'd say, around the sixth or seventh year of the rise of mirrorless cameras. And most mirrorless cameras are several generations later. There was a young lady who showed me her Olympus camera. Where is she? Your Olympus camera. That camera is about four generations from the first pen camera that they came out with. So any camera that you're going to look at B&H today is going to be pretty good in terms of mirrorless. You're several generations into the camera. Do you like to be the person who tests the first generation out? Pay top dollar and test it out? No. Okay, so you don't have to worry about that. So we're in good shape now. The other thing is that there's a selection of lenses on mirrorless cameras. Not only the lenses that the manufacturer builds for those particular cameras, but you can get these adapters and you could use old vintage lenses on them. So maybe you have an old vintage Leica Summicron or maybe an old Olympus Pen FT lens and you want to put it on a new camera. You can do that with mirrorless cameras, which is pretty nice. Now, I shot a lot of my work with the Fuji X-Pro1, which is a mirrorless camera. It's the only mirrorless camera with interchangeable lenses that has an optical viewfinder and an electronic viewfinder. It's the only one that works that way. So the difference between those is that an optical viewfinder allows you, it puts the marks of where the focal length is going to take the picture, but it lets you see on the outside of those marks so you can anticipate subjects moving into your frame, which is really nice. The electronic viewfinder shows you exactly what you're going to get, but it is a digital representation of what you're going to get, not an analog view. The OVF gives you the analog view. Now, I'm a bit of an old school guy. There's another fan of the X-Pro1 user here, legendary photographer Gene Loewinger, and he's a big fan of that optical viewfinder is very unique. Now, it's not for everybody, and there are advantages of an optical viewfinder and an electronic viewfinder. First advantage of the optical is that you can see objects moving into your frame, which is nice. You can also get a real feel of the analog world. The electronic viewfinder, though, does something very neat. That will actually show you exposure compensation and exposure information as you're going to see the image. So remember the old days when we shot with film or standard digital cameras, SLRs, if we set, like say, an overexposure compensation or an underexposure, you can see what you're going to get with the EVF, which is pretty cool. So like, let's say that Laura is very backlit. So I'm going to go to the overexposure compensation. Normal backlit subjects, 1.5 stops usually does the job, but maybe the backlight's not too heavy, so I can go one stop. When I make those settings, I see the picture I'm going to get in the EVF, which is pretty cool. Now, the Fuji X-Pro1 is the only one that does that seamlessly. All the other cameras out there are generally an electronic viewfinder. Now, the X-Pro1 is also getting a little long in the tooth. So it's about 2.5 years old now, 2 years old, so it's that's not so important. The other thing I like about that about the X-Pro1, going to make Matt work for the trailing me around here, is that it happens to feel really good. It looks like a rangefinder and it has a wonderful feel to it. It's a very classic type camera. If you're just getting into digital photography now, I think there's a host of mirrorless cameras that will feel good to you. But if you come from a lineage of film photography and especially rangefinders, you're going to love the X-Pro1. It's really a neat camera. And it's come down in price, but like I said, it's getting fairly old. Now, the other thing about any of the Fujis is they make awesome JPEGs. And I don't say this like for every camera. Some cameras have better make better RAW files. Some cameras make better JPEGs. In this case, the Fuji system makes a really good JPEG. And I'm a JPEG man. How many people here shoot RAW and JPEG at the same time? Okay. I'm just shooting JPEGs now. I know that's almost... Mr. Chesler's like, that's heresy what I'm saying. But I don't shoot RAW files anymore because I find that shooting RAW files makes you do a lot of work on the back end. You're doing a little bit more in processing. JPEGs, getting it right in the camera with a good camera, I think you get a very good JPEG and you're fine. To prove that point, I'll ask you guys to take a look at this book. This is a 12-inch by 12-inch format Blurb book, all done with JPEGs that were processed in Snapseed through an iPad. No Photoshop whatsoever was done in that book. And those are all, those images look great. And I didn't bring in the print, but I had a 16 by 20 that was a JPEG, shot with the Fuji XPro, processed in Snapseed. 16 by 20 looks beautiful. So they're definitely capable. But this isn't about the XPro. This is just what I shoot with and what I'm excited about. It really, this workflow will apply to any of the mirrorless cameras, some of the hybrid cameras, and even if you shoot with an SLR, which takes compact flash or SD cards, you could apply all this workflow to your own setup. But I just really want to focus in on what was actually achieved in that Day of the Dead in the travel photography shooting. So why the iPad? Well, the iPads now come with a Retina display, and the Retina display is really good. The Retina display is super sharp, and you can really see your images very well. Yes, there are Android tablets that are out there, and you certainly could work with them. However, the iPad is just a beautiful piece of hardware. It also has an elegant iOS. The iOS and the iPad is a pleasure to use. Who here has an iPad? Okay, so you guys, do you love your iPad? Because mine is like connected to my left hand when I'm home. It's my 76-year-old mother-in-law thought my wife and I were crazy with the way that we always had our iPads in our hands during breakfast, lunch, dinner, everything in between, sitting on the, constantly referring to it anyway. It's like digital crack. You just, once you start using it, you can't get rid of it. Now, why for travel photography? It's way lighter than a laptop. It's also easy to use. And how many of you guys have ever tried to open up a laptop when you're flying coach? Okay, it's like, it's just the screen. The other thing is the battery life on the iPad rocks. The iPad is, yes, you have to keep an eye on it, but it does last for hours and hours and hours. Much more, an iPad will stay running and let you process much longer than a laptop will, which is great. The other thing is the color space. And there are some new profiles that are out. A profiler from X-Rite, thank you. X-Rite just released a system for that, and I hope that X-Rite people aren't watching me on this video, but they showed it to me, and I thought to myself, it's one more cog in the system. Yeah, do you really need this? Because I was super impressed with the color space on the iPad. Happens to be, I think, really right on the money. If it's not good enough for you, you can buy the X-Rite and you could really profile your device and make it perfect. But I think the color space is spot on, much better than like a Mac was, say, 10 years ago. Connected on the road. The other cool thing about having the iPad with you is that, you know, we all love our iPads, but you can stay connected. And it's just a pleasure to stay connected when you're on the road. Check Facebook, tweet pictures, do things like that, do emails, keep up with it, and the iPad is very elegant and easy to use that way. So that's why I think the iPad rocks. That is to say that a MacBook Air does definitely, it's small, it's compact, but we're going for small, really small. And that's the idea with the iPad. Also, I have an iPad, I think it's a 3 Retina, we're trying to figure out what it is, but it's a full-size iPad. The iPad Mini, you can do this with the Mini as well. The Mini works just as well. This happens to be, I bought this before the Mini came out. And to be honest with you, I like the real estate on this. The Mini, if I want to travel even smaller, the Mini would be fine. But having the full size iPad, I think is kind of nice. Also, when you show pictures, like I have a little pet peeve. I can't stand people that show me pictures on their phone. That's small. And showing it on the Mini isn't bad. But showing pictures on the iPad works fairly well. Okay, why Snapseed? Well, Snapseed has a really easy interface. We're going to go over Snapseed. We're going to look at it. But the interface is really pleasant to use. And this is what's surprising is that if you take a JPEG, you import it into your iPad, and then you open it up with Snapseed, you make some adjustments, and then you save it, there is some destruction happening because it is a JPEG that has been resaved. But it maintains the size of the file. So I thought this was pretty cool. The XPro basically makes, I think there are 4.5 megabyte large JPEGs squished down, but when you open them up, they become 45 megabyte files. After you adjust with Snapseed, it's still a 45 megabyte file. So the Snapseed is actually juggling a full size image around. And the reason why this is important, there's some other apps out there, namely Camera Bag. Camera Bag makes very smaller. It opens it up as a JPEG, makes the adjustments, and then it compresses it much smaller. Snapseed maintains all the integrity of the file. Slightly destructive, but I haven't noticed its destructiveness yet in terms of a print that goes onto a screen or that I do in a book or even a full 16 by 20 print. So it does handle files very well. It's versatile and it's powerful. You can do a lot with Snapseed. And it's, again, it's easy to use. And it's free. Snapseed was bought by Google. Originally, Snapseed was made by our friends from Nick Software. And actually, Tony Corbell came in here a couple of years ago and did a wonderful Nick Software SilverFX Pro and showed us some really good technology. And then he said the orphan brother was Snapseed. And Google bought Nick. And Nick Software is only through the Google brand now. Came down a little bit in price. But I think that Google actually bought it mainly for Snapseed. And that's the reason that Google grabbed up that company. But then they made it Google Snapseed is now free. It used to be $5 or $3 when it was Nick, which I think is the best $3 or $5 I've ever spent in my life for a Snapseed. It worked because how much is Photoshop? Exactly. So, but now it's free. So can you beat it? No, I don't think so. There's some good habits that you should have if you want to do this workflow. First thing you want to do is you want to be a discrete editor. Your iPad can't hold all the images coming off of your card. So you have to discreetly edit. And this is probably, if there is an Achilles heel to this workflow, it's this point. So we're just going to go into our Domke bag here, and I'm going to show you a couple of things. So first off, all your cameras, you're familiar with chimping your camera, right? Chimping is when you hit the preview button and you look back at what you got. So the first step here that you want to do is you want to be able to use the magnify image. You want to go to plus and zoom into your image a little bit so you can see what's going on and check for sharpness. The other thing that you want to do is if you go to minus, you could end up seeing more pictures on your screen at once. So you can scroll through and find where your images are. Because as you're shooting, I don't want you to reformat your card. Keep all your images on the card. But look through your images as you're shooting. Now, I'd like to say I have a saying, and it's called shoot. I think that you should shoot more often, but shoot less. So in other words, don't sit there on the power drive and just keep pounding away images. Shoot very deliberately and shoot often, but don't feel like you have to shoot tons. This is a Hoodman hood loop, and this really helps for editing. It's collapsible, so it fits in your bag pretty nicely. It has a diopter, so you can make it fit to your eyes. But the cool part about the hood loop is that you could really get a good view outside of your images and be able to check for sharpness. I don't know if you can zoom in on this, but I've got a shot that was a low shutter speed, and the picture really got blurry. Took the picture again, refocused it, bumped up the ISO, and the shot was sharp. So if you've got a couple of images, and you're like, let's say you shoot a sequence of 3 or 4 images, you should try to find the best one out of those images. Using the loop and going through the pictures will really help you. The other cool part about using this loop is that when you're outdoors, if it's very bright, the loop really helps you see what's going on with the picture. So I think the loop is a good part of the whole equation, and it really helps you do the editing very well. So, now this is be a discrete editor. I have to say one problem that most people have is that they overdo it. They show lots and lots of pictures. If you go and you photograph the Eiffel Tower, I don't want to see 6 pictures of the Eiffel Tower. I want to see one really good one. And if you look at magazine spreads, where you've sat through Uncle Bob's slideshow, that they show you, people's attention span go pretty quickly. I'd rather see one great photograph than 5 mediocre ones. So you got to edit yourself pretty heavily. You want to download and post edit during the actual, while you're on tour, while you're on the vacation, while you're there. So this means that when you have downtime at hotels or airports, or while you're flying or transporting in between, or cafe breaks, this is a good time to download images and work on them in Snapseed. I'm quite happy and with the way this turned out. This book, all the images that were in this book, all the final edit, and I went fairly heavy on it. All these images, when I stepped off the plane in New York City after the trip, I was done editing. That means I didn't go back, I didn't have my memory cards and download them for weeks later. Because when you come back from a trip, you make that abrupt jump right back into real time. So you want to edit as you're actually going. And I don't think that we edit so often, because how can, if you're at a cafe, can you whip out a laptop and comfortably sit there and do some editing at a cafe? But whipping out an iPad, it's just easy to work with. The trip that we did the Day of the Dead, it was four cities, and we used a bus, a chartered bus, to get in between the cities. So instead of sleeping or reading, I was editing my photos. So it's really cool if you can, like, get off your, like, Charles, when you go to Africa, winner of the Wilderness Photo, B&H Wilderness Photo Competition, popular vote, you've got a long flight coming back from Africa. Perfect time to do the editing. And I think I had a distinct advantage on doing the editing in between each segment because I was closer to my subjects. In other words, I went into the Juarez market, I shot, and then we were in a bus for 2 hours, immediately started editing that sequence of the Juarez market. What a wonderful way to do it, because I was very familiar with the images then. If you edit maybe a couple of weeks later, you start to lose track of, oh, was this in the Juarez market, or was this in the Monterey market, or where was it? If you work very quickly, you'll sort of be more attached to your work. Okay, the other one, and this is for us Fuji users, you're gonna charge your batteries and devices every night. So first thing I would do when I went into the hotel, I would find the AC sockets, and I would put my, in my luggage, I carried the chargers, but I would immediately start to charge the batteries. And you definitely want to travel with at least two batteries. Absolutely. So that when one battery goes down, you got another battery. Now, I jokingly said the Fujis, one of probably, I have to say, I think the only negative I can really say in the Fujis is that the batteries go fairly quickly. Working with some of the Nikon cameras, the Nikon J series, I think you can shoot practically 450 shots with those batteries. They're very efficient. Fuji, great sensors, not the best batteries. So every night when you go to bed, you should put your batteries onto the chargers so that in the morning, you've got fresh batteries, you don't have to worry about it. Nothing is worse. Remember, a digital camera, when the battery dies, you're done. It's not like a Nikon F3 that you could put it onto the X setting and keep shooting with like one shutter speed. No, you're done. So charge your batteries up every night. Now, I didn't put this on the cheat sheet, but if your battery charger comes like this with a cord on it, there is an adapter you can get that just goes into the side and lets you plug that into the wall, so you don't have to travel with these long wires. We do actually sell one of those. You can search plug adapter and it'll come up. I think that's wonderful. I can't stand having a load of cords with me when I'm traveling. Okay, now here's another one. Because you've got the iPad and you're connected on the road, you can inspire yourself and inspire others by simply taking the best picture that you shot that day. You're at night on the hotel, update the photo, edit it, and then post it to your Facebook or tweet about it. Now, why this is kind of cool is that, who here is on Facebook? Okay, did you ever get like 150 likes on a photo? That's like, yeah. That kind of inspires you. That kind of keeps you motivated. Everyone loves where I'm traveling. The picture looks good. Now, I have a pet peeve, and I don't know if it's just me, but you don't need to do, if you upload to Facebook, say, 5 images from that day that looked really good, Facebook shows you a montage of the 5 images. It doesn't show on the feed just the one image. I tend to not click on those and don't respond to that as well. If you tweet one image or you upload one picture to Facebook, you're treating your followers well because you're editing yourself. You're not showing them a bunch of images. It has more impact, one really good image, than 5 images. So try to be a little conscious of that. But having your iPad right there is just so easy to update. So I think it'll motivate you a little bit more as people make comments, and also you're sharing photos across the world, wherever you are with your friends. How fun is that? Your family. It's great to do that. So that's good. Just one. Don't do 20 uploads per day. Okay, the best habit that you can do is that you guys are photographers, and we're blessed as photographers. Keep your eyes open. Be ready to make pictures all the time. And the wonderful thing about this workflow is that the equipment is small. It can stay with you. It's right over your shoulder. Subject's a little bit far away. You're going to work with a longer lens. I've got the amazing vista in front of me. I'm going to work with a wide-angle lens. It's right here. You can grab it. Being a photographer lets you uniquely enter an environment and really look at it and see details. We see things that normal people don't see because we're constantly looking at the world as if it's a viewfinder trying to find a photograph. This was shot in Baja, Mexico on a Lindblad Expeditions trip. This is one of the guests. He was a really great guest. And looking at this photograph, I saw all this open space. The sun was setting, the sky turned pink. It was perfect. And I said, I know I'll be able to use that photo for something. So keep your eyes open. You never know when that shot's going to be in front of you. So we talked a little bit about shooting RAW or JPEG. And you can shoot RAW, or you can shoot JPEG, or you can shoot both. If you shoot both, that allows you to work with the JPEGs so that you can upload it. You can put it into your iPad. You can upload it onto websites. You can email it. Very easy to do it. If you shoot RAW, you got to slow down and process the image a little bit. Snapseed does not work with RAW photos. Snapseed only works with JPEG photos. So the app-based easy photo editors generally don't work with RAW. So RAW is going to be for that award-winning shot. You're going to have it on your hard drive. When you're ready to use that shot, then you can go into RAW and you can edit that image and work with it. You can shoot with both. For many years, I shot with both. Recently, I've been shooting just JPEG and not RAW, as I said before. So when you're in the field, this is the most boring slide in the whole presentation. This is a little bit of workflow steps when you're in the field. So when you're shooting, you're going to edit in your camera first, and you're going to choose your best shots, or your best shoots, shot shoots. So what you're going to do with that is that, let's talk about when you edit in camera and then you download to the iPad, you can't do tons and tons of photos. You got to make sure that per sequence, like you go to a cathedral, what's like the one or two best shots of that cathedral? What are the one or two best shots of the Eiffel Tower? If you can't decide, relax a little bit, take out that loop, really look at the pictures, and try to narrow your pictures down. So you got to edit in your camera first. Then you're going to download your best to the iPad. Now the way you download it is with a card reader, and it's going to show you all the images on that card, and then you're going to select the pictures that you want to download. Only problem is that when you get to that point, the pictures are very small. So you really can't edit from the card in the iPad. The pictures are going to be tiny. So what you're going to do is you're trying to look at the area of the photographs that you've taken, and then when you're downloading your pictures, you'll see them. And it's a little difficult to do, but you can get used to it. You're working with a very small little picture, though. So first thing you do is on your iPad, you're going to create an album with the name and the date, the trip name and the date. I'm going to show you some screenshots in a second. Then you're going to create a second album with the name and edit. So for those of you that have, I'm going to just do this on the iPad real fast here. Let's see how this works. Hold on. Okay, so here's the iPad, and we're going to go to Photos, and we're going to go to Albums, and you're going to see a number of albums that I have here. And so Mexico 2013 was the first folder, and all the images that I was shooting ended up in this Mexico 2013. Then as I was editing those images down, I was saving it into the Day of the Dead, the Mexi edit file. So this was all the slightly edited ones. And then as I really edited the best ones, I created another one called Day of the Dead. So I'm creating three folders to slowly edit down my images. Hold on. Okay. And now it's going to want to go to that. Okay, so we've got two folders on the iPad now that have the name and date, and then the name and a type of edit that I've done. And you can customize this to the way you want to do it. So once we downloaded our images, they go into a folder called Last Import. From Last Import, we're going to move them into the Trip and Date folder. Then we're going to use Snapseed, is going to look at the name and date folder, and we're going to do some stuff with Snapseed. When Snapseed saves the image, after you click Save, it sends it to a folder called Camera Roll. And then from Camera Roll, we can move those images into the name and the edited file. So if that sounds a little bit confusing, it's a little bit of a tough way to juggle your images around an iPad. For those of you that are familiar with Lightroom, Lightroom sort of does this for you on a laptop. On an iPad, we got to work a little bit. So we're going to create two folders and then when we import our images into the iPad, we're going to find them under Last Import, and then we're going to move them to Name and Date. And then we're going to use Snapseed. Snapseed's going to look at the name and date folder, pick the images you want. Snapseed's going to save them to the camera roll. And then last thing we're going to do is then from the camera roll, we're going to bring them to the trip and edit, the trip and edit destination folder, which is the name and edit. Yeah. Which actually we have to correct that. It should say tripping at it. So that's the way that the workflow actually works. So it's download and it ends up in last import. Open it up with Snapseed. Do your saving it. It saves it automatically to the camera roll, and then we find it on the camera roll and we put it into that folder. This workflow took me a while to figure out because I had images all over the iPad. They were in camera roll, they were in the last import, they were showing up in different places. But if you kind of stick with this, you'll know where your images are. And that's important because later on, when we get home, keep all your images on. Make sure that you select the images and keep them on the, you don't want to discard the images on your memory card. It will ask you if you want to do that. You don't want to do that. And don't format your card. I want to keep all your pictures on the card. That's like your backup. Now you've got your iPad organized. The next step is when you're back in your home base, how do you get the images out of your iPad to your computer? And why would you want to put it on your computer? Well, you want to archive it properly so you can free up space on your iPad. The other reason I wanted to do it was that my whole goal was to make this book. So I need to take all these images that I manipulated with Snapseed and put it onto a folder so that I can grab those images to put on my blog and also put into the book. So not that I was using any more Photoshop, but I needed that to happen. So to get the images off the iPad, it's a little bit tricky. So what you're going to do is your archive drive, which would be like, in my case, this is a regular hard drive, because I like to keep all my images on a drive and not on the drive of the computer itself. On that, I put a folder called Trip and Date. So that was the Day of the Dead, November 2013. In this folder, I put a subfolder called Worked. Now, why I do it Worked is that I downloaded all the cards, the memory cards, not the iPad Snapseed workflow stuff. All the cards I downloaded to the Trip and Date. Now, inside the Trip and Date subfolder, I had Worked. Didn't touch that yet. So all the information, the raw files, the JPEG files, whatever you shoot, that goes to your archive. And then you leave that alone. Don't touch it, because you may need that later on. But then downloading the files from the iPad, that went into the Worked folder. Why is it the Worked folder? Because I've already worked it. I've already edited it. I've already played with it in Snapseed and made changes to the photograph. So I've got a folder that says Mexico trip 2013. Inside that folder, it says Worked. On the first level, 2014 or 2013 are all the images that I shot. I downloaded all the cards. Then in the Worked one, I go to and make the iPad download the pictures that I've changed with Snapseed. Now, this one gets a little bit tough. There's a photo transfer app that works really well that I like to use, and using Wi-Fi. So this is the photo transfer app, what it looks like, little picture, so you can find it in the App Store if you do want to use it. And what it does is that these are screenshots from the iPad. So from the iPad, this is what I see, and these are all my folders in the photo area. So I can pick Day of the Dead, 63 photos. That's the one that I want to bring over and download to my computer. So on the computer, it gives me the iPad gives me in the transfer app, it gives me a URL that I actually use a browser for, where I can download. There's also an app that I can download for the laptop, but I like to use the browser for this. And the browser lets me select images two different ways, full resolution or medium. Obviously, we want to go full resolution, the full thing. And we can select our pictures and then download it. So this is a screenshot. This is what my computer sees. This is a special URL that was given to me by Photo Transfer. And so I've got all this stuff going across Photo Transfer app, the download. I'm going to select the images that I want to download. And voila, I'm good. I've got my pictures downloaded to that I've worked with Snapseed into a folder that's worked. It shows the edited images. That's my workflow. That's the way that I work with this. You can come up with your own stuff. You can connect your iPad to your computer, and iPhoto will open up. I'm not a big fan of iPhoto. Actually, iPhoto is going. They're going to have the new photo app now because Aperture is done. iPhoto will also do this for you. But iPhoto, like I said, I don't like launching iPhoto. I don't like using iPhoto anymore. Who here likes iPhoto? Does anyone like iPhoto? Okay. All right, so two people raise their hand. My problem with iPhoto is that it puts images all over the hard drive. It's like it uses up a lot of memory in the computer. What about Lightroom? Could you use Lightroom with this? Yes, you could use Lightroom with it, but you don't need Lightroom to play with the images that you already manipulated in Snapseed. You can use Lightroom to manage all your RAW and JPEG folders, the shots that were on the memory card. We're just talking about workflow with Snapseed, though, so we're not going to talk so much about Lightroom. We're not going to ride that roller coaster, because we could be here for hours talking about Lightroom. That's a massive program. Okay, so while you're at this for travel photography, I want you guys to own your own images. In other words, if Laura and I were standing next to each other, we were shooting the Statue of Liberty, and we're standing in the same spot with maybe the same gear, the same lenses, our images would look pretty similar, wouldn't they? And you're taking pictures with the same equipment right next to each other. But you can do something to own your image, and it's about putting a style onto the photograph. So this is in camera. This is not iPad or Snapseed yet. This is totally in camera. So on the Fuji system, they have film simulation modes. And film simulation modes allow you to choose about 6 different looks based upon Fuji films that had come out in the past. So Velvia was a very saturated look. This is my wife, Barbara. Barbara, thank you for modeling for us. Look at the shoes in Velvia. They're very popping and very bright. And look at the green in the background on that. Now, Astia was a Fuji film that had very soft contrast. Look at the difference in the shoes between those two. And look at the greens aren't as punchy. And then black and white, there's 3 filters that you can use for black and white. There's red, green, and yellow. Yellow, if you have a lot of clouds in the sky, red or yellow will make the clouds punch. But if you're shooting people, green filter is very good for skin tones. So I chose the green filter on that. The interesting thing about the Fuji is that you could put on, it's called film modes bracketing, where I can tell the camera, I can shoot once, and the camera takes 3 different styles it throws onto it. So it's kind of the best of both worlds. It's a pretty neat feature that it has. I think some of the other companies also have that as well. But the cool part is that let's say that Laura and I were shooting Barbara, and Laura had her camera in color mode, I had my camera in black and white mode. Thus, we shot the same subject with maybe the same equipment, yet by applying that film style, it becomes much different. Now, when you shoot with a style and you put a style onto it, if you shoot RAW and JPEG, the JPEG will have that style, but the RAW one will have color information, it'll have everything there that you can make these decisions later on in post-processing. But if you shoot with RAW and JPEG, the JPEG will always have that change of that image. The interesting thing about applying a style like that, which I'm a huge fan of, is that when you shoot black and white, the picture comes out black and white on the back of the screen. And why we like that is that we can sort of get an idea of what we're doing in black and white versus in color and see it on the screen. Now, if I shoot RAW and JPEG, the RAW file is still in there, and I've got all that color information built into it, but it shows me the black and white JPEG. So it's kind of cool, because it's really the best of both worlds it's giving us. Okay, so this is some of the saturation modes, and it's getting a little bit more saturated of a look. Blues get a little bluer, and there's a generally more of a warmth that happens when we apply that style. This is another saturated one. So this was on, this was shot on Halloween 2 years ago when Hurricane Sandy came, and it was uptown where there was still power. People still party and go to parties. I love it. But I saw them across the street. I ran to get this shot because this one had to be, you had to take this one fast and move along. But the saturation worked really good. I played with this in black and white mode. It doesn't look as good in black and white. It definitely works better in color. This is from a Sony camera, and this is a high contrast black and white. This is another high contrast black and white shot. Just a little bit of street shooting. So I've showed you guys applying a style and looking at different ways at your photograph. This is actually using a different format. This is one of my favorite ones to work with. Trying a different format allows you, this is the square format, and here's all different formats with the same camera, same subject. So normally, 4x3 is our standard format. That's the standard rectangular format that most cameras work with. But you can shoot 16x9, 3x2, or that square format, 1x1. An argument for shooting JPEG and RAW, if you shoot JPEG and RAW, your RAW file will be the full file, everything that you see. But if you do RAW plus JPEG, you get the square JPEGs. I did a whole series on Italy only shooting square, and it was liberating to think and to shoot in just square. I'll show some images on that in a second. So that's pretty cool. Actually, this shot, this got, from this sequence, it got the cover of a book, composition book, in French, which I thought was pretty cool. Unfortunately, I signed the straight payout and not the not the royalties, so when they used one of my pictures for the cover of the book, it didn't. This is the Galleria Manuel in Milan. Okay, so shooting RAW and JPEG, we talked about this. The style is saved on the JPEG, but the RAW, you get a RAW image. You can do anything you want with it. But one thing I like about shooting JPEG, you're living on the edge when you shoot just JPEG and you apply a style. Because if you shoot that way, that's all you get. There's no safety net of a RAW file. Who likes to live on the edge? Okay, only a few of you guys. Everyone else wants to be safe. Make sure their files are in color and black and white. The one thing I call this shooting with conviction. I'm gonna shoot black and white. I'm gonna do a really good job because if I blow it, I don't have that RAW massive exposure latitude to play with. When you shoot JPEG, you gotta get it right. So that's kind of, it puts a little bit of a photographic edge on yourself. I don't know if you guys like to make your life difficult, but you know, it's how we roll. Okay, so let's talk gear. What does this this whole travel photography mean? Well, you gotta have something to download to your iPad with. I'm gonna show you some slides in a moment with that. We're going to work with a discrete bag. Now, a discrete bag, so the bag that you bought, it's pretty discreet. There are more discreet bags, but you don't want a bag that screams, I'm a camera bag, I have expensive gear in here. That's not good, you know, you don't want that. That's never good. A maid in a hotel could steal from you. You could get stolen at a bar or at a cafe. You want to be discreet with your bags. And that's why I really love this these Domke bags. The Domke bags are fairly discreet bags. It looks like a kind of a standard satchel. So it's pretty discreet. Still, I think if you know what you're, an educated thief will be able to determine that this is a camera bag. This bag over here is pretty cool. This is a 1944 vintage U.S. Army ammo bag. Inside of it, we've got a wonderful travel camera. We've got the Sony RX10. But what I've done with this bag is that, and you can buy them out here, this is a Domke insert. You can buy inserts of different sizes and make any bag a camera bag. The photographer Len Spire used to roll around with a Pan Am bag. So now you could take a towel and wrap it around cameras and all sorts of stuff like that. But these Domke inserts were made for this. And I just recently modified this one. I cut the bag so that I had one larger rectangle there. And then you've got for lenses, the two small ones on the back. But so also this gives a little bit of a shape to the bag. But rolling around with this vintage bag, I mean, this doesn't look like a camera bag. It doesn't look like it's holding a $1,000 camera. So I would feel pretty confident going anywhere with this bag. You know, it was good enough for US soldiers to carry their ammo in. Look like a terrorist. Well, I don't quite think I look like a terrorist, but okay. But well, you can do any bag, any generic bag. Even a rough looking bag, I think, has its place because you can be very discreet with it. Okay, gotta have a lens cloth, right? Of course, because if you ever check your, like when you're shooting, sometimes I look down at a lens, I'm like, oh my God, look at all the dust that's on the lens. So having a lens cloth is great. You wanna throw that hood loop in there, that Hoodman hood loop. I like the collapsible. Even though it says this is a 3.2 inch and it says for Canon, 3.2 inch will work with any camera you've had and any camera you're gonna buy. I don't think we're really having things that are bigger than 3 inches. So this works out really well. And also it's a shot glass. It's a good quality glass in the hood loop. This costs $99 and it's got a simple little strap it comes with, but it's a good little setup. And it comes in a case as well. Extra batteries, we talked about the importance of that. You gotta have extra batteries. Have at least 2 batteries in your camera bag. You wanna have your chargers with the plug adapter for charging. So the plug adapter, that's the Franz plug adapters, Franzis, we sell them. That's the Euro plug adapter is the one for across the world. You wanna make sure you have a couple of those plug adapters so you can charge up the batteries when you're in Europe. Mexico was standard 2 prongs, it was okay. But if you travel in Europe, you have to have the round prongs, not the flat prongs. You wanna have a card wallet or a card holder. So that's important to have something to hold your cards in. On the cheat sheet, I mentioned a card holder for you guys that's on there. I like a nice low profile, small card reader. You don't wanna have one of those bulky weather, like the real good ones are like $15 and they're underwater, they're sealed, they're like little pelican cases. They're too big. You want something nice and small and discreet, which works out good. I put on the cheat sheet for you guys a real small one that's out there. You want to have a basic filter set up. So this is pretty important. You want to have a circular polarizer is key. And if you want a, I don't think you really have to have a graduated neutral density filter, but if there are, there are something called, I have it on your cheat sheet, it's the Tiffin variable neutral density filter. So it's one filter that you could rotate and it stops from plus one to like plus 10. So it really limits the light that's going through it. Circular polarizers for taking away reflections, shooting through glass, very important. Having the neutral density filter, the big advantage to that is if you like to shoot wide open and eliminate depth of field, if you shoot wide open, the shutter speed goes very, very high. Usually you bottom out your shutter speed or you max it out. Putting a neutral density filter on there will allow you to shoot wide open yet not have as much light going through it, so the shutter speed can stay not a 12,000th or a 20,000th of a second, which cameras can't do. So this is some essential gear. And just to show you kind of what fits into this bag, in the back pocket, the iPad went. It's got two zippers up front, and in the zippers we have the card adapter, so I can download my SD cards down. That goes into the card adapter. And inside of it is simple setup. We got camera, one lens on it. We've got underneath that goes the hood loop. And in the other pocket, I've got two other lenses. And I keep one lens in a case so that I can stack another lens on top of it. You don't want to stack lenses on top of each other. Now, when you work with a big camera bag for a normal setup, you can have a pocket for every lens and a whole area for every lens. But in this setup, you're going to have to stack lenses on top of each other to maintain the small size. So having a case for one lens works out really well. Inside these pockets, I've got something cool. Another camera. So I'm going to talk about the Instax camera in a second. Always got to have a pen with you. And then another little thing I like is that having a little notebook, take notes down on what you're shooting, really important. So have a small, discreet, like one of those moleskin bags, which is really good. And then in here, I've got an extra battery. I took the battery out already. So that's basically the contents of the one bag. We'll show you these Instax cameras in a moment. Okay, so if you want to connect your iPad and download, you can, if you have iPad first, second, or third generation, you can get the iPad camera connection kit, $26. It comes with a SD card reader or one that you can connect the camera right to your iPad and not have to work with a card reader. So you can work with that little guy. Now, it will download RAW and JPEG when you choose your pictures. And that's where you eat up the memory in your iPad very quickly if you're shooting RAW and JPEG. So that's why I like to just shoot JPEG so that not so many files are going back and forth to the iPad. If you have the iPad Air, which is considered fourth generation, or the Mini, then you've got the little Thunderbolt, the little Mini connector. So it's a little different connector. So for that one, you want to work with this, and I have this on your cheat sheet, the APM-LSD-CR, which will work for that. Now, what if you say, David, that's great, but I'm going to be traveling with my Nikon, my Canon 5D Mark III, which is CF cards, compact flash, or maybe my Nikon D800, which is CF cards, and you want to work with this. We don't sell anything, but I found you something. On Photo Jojo, there is a setup, they sell something so you can download CF cards to your iPad. But Apple doesn't support CF cards and they don't make an adapter for that. So you have to go to Photo Jojo to get that. You can take that URL down and you can do that. Okay, so here's the bag that I was recommending, the Domke F803 bag, which is a pretty cool bag, very discreet. It also comes in a couple of different finishes. They've got black, olive, and tan, and then they've got like a distressed, which is a little bit more waterproof. I think it's a sharp looking bag and you look like a real journalist with that bag. So pretty discreet. How much memory do you want to bring with you? That depends. If you're shooting RAW and JPEG, I would say that you probably want to bring at least 32 gigabytes. If you're just shooting JPEG, to be honest with you, a 16 gigabyte card was good enough for me on that. So you don't have to go too crazy shooting, buying memory cards. I like working with at least two cards. I kind of feel safe with that. In case anything happens, I've got a backup card. So this is the real, I have this on your cheat sheet as well. This is a really small card holder. It's super discreet, and it's like only cost $6.95, and it's extremely lightweight. It's like made of nothing, but it does fit in the top pockets. It fits in this pocket of the 803 bag, which is nice. Okay, so you're probably wondering what this little guy is. This is my key for travel photography. This is a Fuji Instax camera, which lets you take a picture right away. Some hints with the Instax is that you want to fill the frame up nicely. And the cool part about this camera is that this is a door opener. You can take a picture, especially in a third world country, of somebody with the little Instax, and you've got them. You've got this guy is he's cutting porchetta at the Chelsea market. I took a picture of him with the iPad to get him to smile and break the ice, gave him the picture, and then I took out the XPro 1 and really did some serious portrait work for him. So it's a really cool little camera to have. There's two models. There's the Classic, and then there's the 25. The 25 only cost $83. The Classic cost $150. The Classic has a self-timer and better exposure compensation going on with it, so it's a little bit more involved, and it looks nice. The one thing, though, about the Classic is it's a little bit bigger of a camera. The Mini 25 is a little smaller, but I got to admit, this is a beautiful-looking camera. It takes super sharp pictures. It really does. So here was a shot in Day of the Dead, there was a family, and the little girl was beautiful. She was doing the Katrina face, the sugar skull. So I took a picture of her, and then Fujifilm also makes seasonal, this is the pink and the rainbow. This was a Halloween one, so it had the little Halloween icons on it. She was thrilled with this. I started photographing her and her brother after this. Made great photographs after that. It's an icebreaker. I don't speak Spanish. She didn't speak English. We spoke the language of photography. Her little brother was running around going, mira, 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 which means look in Spanish. He was so good. So real fast, I want to give you guys some tips. Fill the frame. Shoot tight. It's not a very big picture, so you want to really try to fill the frame with your subject as best as you possibly can. Store your shots in the containers that they come in. The Instax comes in these little containers, and I think I have one extra one here. Yep, I can feel it. So here's a little, here's some Fujifilm, and also, what's fun about working with the Instax, it's like you're a photographer again with analog. You know, you're loading film in. You're not slipping a memory card in. So you slip this into the back of the Instax, and this is where the pictures come out of. You can also take this and you rip off this piece of tape, and then you can store your pictures in here. Be careful if you take an Instax and you put them in your pockets, you kind of forget about them, because later on you're going to maybe want to scan your Instax shots or take pictures of them. And if you scratch the emulsion, that's not good. So I like to store them in the case that they come in. Or worst case scenario, keep the bag and just stuff them into the box that they came in. So you got them, and they'll be in good shape. Okay. And then the other tip is the shutter release button on the camera can be the shutter release is that you can do a selfie with it. And the shutter release button, that little mirror, is pretty accurate, so I can really frame my picture really good. Let me get you guys in the background. So, got to do a selfie. This mini isn't the shutter release button, but that little piece of reflective material, that's your mirror there, so you can, and it's pretty accurate. You can really crop yourself pretty perfectly with it, which is kind of cool. Okay, the other one is that you want to be careful shooting in developing countries or third world countries, because you could become really popular with that Instax, okay? Especially India. My friend Gabe Biederman teaches here. He was in India, and he was like, there was one village that he was the most popular guy in the village, and he burned through his film pretty quickly. I didn't see any of that Instax film when I was in Mexico. So if you go into a remote area, you may not be able to get it. And I like to put that film in my luggage and only carry in my camera bag one or two replacement ones for it. The film costs $14 for 20 pictures, so it's pretty economical. I don't have one with me, but Fuji just came out with something pretty cool. It's a printer that's the size of the camera that takes the Instax film, but with Wi-Fi, it will actually take a signal from your phone and you can print out anything on the Instax. Any picture can be printed out Instax size. It's really neat. It's a pretty cool thing. Got to get Fuji in here to show that off. So that's my thing with the Instax. It's a door opener, lets you out there. And I'm going to throw one more thing out to you guys. Imagine it's a developing country and I got both of us in there.
Oh yeah.
Slowly coming out. Well, that's accurate though. So you as a traveler travel to a location. It's amazing. It's great. It's much different than everything that you know. How can you give back to them? Well, there is ecotourism, which is really good for a country's economy. But I'll tell you what though, giving those pictures to the little boy, the Mexican family, and their day, I don't know what kind of camera their mom had, but they had a picture. But could you imagine traveling in Africa in the bush into a really remote location? You may be the first time that you've taken pictures of these people and given it to them. So how long will that little instant photo last? They could have that up in their house. It's like really giving back to somebody, sharing photography and sharing goodwill. So I tend to give out more of my Instax photos than I keep myself. If it's a really cool shot, I want to keep it. Sometimes I'll shoot twice. You know, since we got time, I'll tell you a quick story. We go to Italy every year, and in the market, there's a farmer's family that comes to brings their harvest to the market, and there's a real old guy. And for years, I had been talking to the old guy in my broken Italian. My wife's family knew him. My wife knew him. We went last year, and he was getting, when I first met him, he was working in the stall, and then all of a sudden, he was just selling herbs on the side, and his daughter-in-law and his son were manning the booth. So I went this year, and first thing, looked around and didn't see him. And we asked his wife, and he had passed away. The year before, I took a picture of him with the Instax and took some pictures with the Fuji XPro. And I took the picture and I put it into his top pocket because he was very old and kind of like, you know. So I put it into his pocket, and I wonder, you know, what he did with that picture. Did he ever discover it later on? Was he like, whoa, a photo? So that picture kind of lived on. I felt so bad that he passed away, but at least I was able to photograph him. I photographed his hands. He had very cool hands. I'll show you the picture later. Okay, so travel photography, it's about capturing the spirit of place, where you're at. That means the weather they have, the architecture, the landscape, all that stuff is important. So in this shot, I'm here looking through this beautiful window that frames the whole shot great. But then I went through the door and stepped out onto the balcony and was able to make this shot. Travel photography is about integrating yourself into that land and really capturing it. I love the bird up on top. That's what made me so happy. But you can tell it's Italy just with that, with the way the roofs look and how that goes. So we talked a lot about the Eiffel Tower, and I want to talk about cliches. I think that you have to photograph a cliche. If a tourist comes to New York City, got to get a picture of the Empire State Building, the Statue of Liberty. If we travel to Paris, you got to get a picture of the Eiffel Tower, right? But it's a cliche. Anytime you can go into tourist trap place and find postcards that are going to look really good of the Eiffel Tower. But you're a travel photographer, you have to photograph it. So I kind of had a bit of a problem with this, and I've avoided shooting the cliche shots, and I kind of regret it. So I asked one of my mentors, Bob Crist, National Geographic traveler photographer, Bob Crist, how do you approach shooting the cliche shot? And he was like, that's the $40,000 question, David. But he gave me a couple of suggestions. So first one was try to find a reflection of the landmark instead of shooting the Eiffel Tower. Try to find maybe a puddle or maybe a wading pool or a garden and try to get a reflection of it. Or integrate the landmark into the background of another shot. So this isn't a shot with the whole frame being the Eiffel Tower. This is Pierre, the street musician, and in the background is the Eiffel Tower. So being able to take the cliche landmark and making it part of the background, which is really good. Or one of my favorites, shoot a detail of the landmark, not the whole thing. So shoot some of the geometry of the, like here's the Galleria in Milan, and I shot a detail of it and tried to play with the geometry of it as opposed to shooting the whole thing. So that was Bob Crist, legendary photographer, his help for us. So I want to thank Bob Crist for those great suggestions on it. Okay, so integrating places, having names in there helps with travel photography. Also, play with the perspective. Shoot up. Don't always shoot straight at your eye level. maybe shoot worms level, get down low, hold your camera down to the bottom. If you've got a camera with a swing out screen, how neat would it be to take a picture right down on the ground, swinging out the LCD screen, looking up at something, change your perspective a little bit. That's a great way to make your photograph stand out. This was in an abandoned hospital, moving through that and photographing that. I wanted to get a picture of one of the signs that was in the hospital to kind of give an indication of what you're in. You're in the consultorio. So what is this?
Children.
The children's wing, exactly. Definitely, you know, Italy, because it's an Italian. and I love black and white. I think black and white in photography, if you haven't turned your camera into black and white, play around with that and see the world in black and white. It's like photography was in the Hinter days. Black and white just works out so good. So the last lesson I want to give you, I want to quote another great photographer, New York photographer Jay Mizell. When I was shooting the Day of the Dead project, this was going through my head the entire time. And you have to say it in a real gruff Jay Mizell voice. You're responsible for every millimeter of your frame. So what does that really mean? No branches coming out of the heads of subjects. There's a good composition going on. Everything in the frame is there for a reason and makes sense. So this is kind of Jay Mizell's take on it. And I had him in the back of my head the entire time I was shooting, especially shooting people on the go, on location. I can't take a Mexican flower girl and ask her, please come, you know, stand over here. That background is really cluttered. That's not really cool. You can't really make your people move around too much. So I'd really have to work the subject until I finally got, you know, I'm looking at you and I got people behind everybody. But if I get a low angle, now I've got a gray background on you. So try to work that in your compositions. You know, use your eye to really see it. And sometimes you take your camera and hold it up to your eye and move around a little bit until you get that right spot and you can actually see it. Okay, so we're gonna go for a little slideshow and then we're gonna do a little tour of Snapseed. How's everybody doing so far?
Good.
All right, no one's falling asleep on me? Okay, good. Okay. So I wanna show this Day of the Dead work because I'm pretty happy with it. Okay, so the Day of the Dead celebration is November 2nd in Mexico. Mexico is a turbulent country. This was a tour specifically to go visit the sites that they did the Day of the Dead celebrations. It was led by a wonderful historian, a Mexican historian, who's working on Mexico and death. If Mexico and death sounds like a little bit of a crazy thing, they actually have a National Museum of Death. It's in Aguascalientes. Mexico and death, they don't treat death like we do here up in the States, where we're very afraid of death and we put it at arm's length. They embrace it and they put it as part of their culture. So this little guy dressed up was great. Can anyone tell me, there's one critical error in this photograph that I can't stand. Let's see what you guys got. Yes. Yep. Yeah. I know, it killed me that was there. I did for the shot for, I used this picture and I did Photoshop and clone that out. But if Jay Mizell saw that triangle, what would he say? Exactly. So here's her, and she was in front of this fabulous museum and this fabulous cathedral in Zacatecas. So I wanted to get her, integrate her into that. And she was so serious. This was another all guys celebrating. This was like a military uniform. Ask him to step over and get that shot. This was the Day of the Dead is about feasting. So this was, there's a lot of food going on. It's got some kind of a potato set up. And this is pan de muerte, which is the special bread that's only baked around Day of the Dead. It's like that's the pastry for Day of the Dead. This is in the cemetery. She brings her pet into the cemetery to go visit the departed. Little kid selling cheese. I love that the Mexicans are just such awesome people. They're great. I don't know if this was his dad or not. But these are special flowers that they put into the onto the grave sites. This is flowers from a cactus. Only grows a certain time of year and only used for Day of the Dead celebration. And again, food was very important. This was jicama. This was a transvestite tarot reader in the Juarez market in Monterrey. She was pretty sweet and interesting. It was a really weird market, Juarez market. Again, partying in the cemetery, and she has a wig on that's not her hair, but she dressed up a little bit for it. Very festive. It was the most festive cemetery I've ever seen. The little kids visiting their grandparents. Again, look at the smile. It was great. This was just on the streets, classic kind of like a FSA photographer's look at things. And these were just people. I really centered on the people. I think the people were just fabulous. This is Salvador. He was the who led our expedition, our field trip. And again, just more people. Asked them. These were our bus drivers. I thought those guys were great. What a pair. And they were kind of funny. But boy, when I picked up that camera, they got serious. They were straight up. But the food was very important. And he got an Instax shot. You know, it's hard to get a smile like this, a connection with that, but using the Instax, got the connection. Also, look at the size of that cleaver. Yeah. Pretty heavy duty. Now, this one was, I did an Instax of this. I call this photograph diaper-flavored peanuts. Hygiene and the Board of Health is a little bit different in Mexico. But I did take an Instax shot and gave it to the father and then took these photos. I think that this was a great... I don't think that this guy would ever get a shot like that of his kid with the Instax. So I was a hit with the family. I walked back by that stall later on and they were like showing off the pictures. Just it's photo karma, it's really good. So I want to show you this picture in particular. So this is a trick in photography. It's called anticipating the moment. So I saw this guy walking up with the Pane Muerta and I was like, I gotta get him. So I ran up the street, stood there with the camera, nice and discreet, and placed myself so that I could get him right at that spot. Not in the doorway, not over here. I wanted this black area around. So waited for him to get there, and he knew what I was doing. I guess he's used to tourists. But he just turns around and gives me this little look right at the right spot. Boom, nailed it. It was so cool to kind of predict where he'd be to get that shot. This is a father-daughter team. Very low shutter speed. It was pretty dark, but I love the sharpness on the girl's eyes. And they got an Instax as well. So these were just details, the Mexican wrestling. This was with the 12mm Zeiss lens, and this is their highways, and this was the overpass for the highways. Use the red filter to increase drama and really get it saturated and punched up. And you know, this is another one, just like using that J. Mizell. These lines, I spent some time composing this and getting this just right. I had a little problem with that square, but was able to justify it in the viewfinder at just the right spot. I want to also say that photography can be time consuming, and my wife has been like traveling. We've been married for almost 11 years now, and she's, when I hold up that camera and I get into the zone, she knows that she should just go and look at something else that I'm working on that composition. It's magic when you hold up the camera to your eyes and you really start getting into the zone. So now this shot was through a window, and it was important to me because the Cronut had just come out in Dominic and Sal's bakery. So I wanted to get a shot of this. This was the Mexican Cronut. This was shot through a glass, and I didn't have a polarizer. I need to make the shot quick. So I just put the camera lens right up against the glass to minimize the glare. So if you don't have a polarizer, try to get as close as you can to the glass to minimize the glare. Details, using depth of field and getting the food, since food was so important, try to get that out there. She was definitely an interesting looking cook, but I wanted to really concentrate on what she was doing. And these were just elements that were all during the whole trip in the museum, shooting outside. It's our friend again. Again, more details. I have a whole series with cars, shooting cars, pretty straightforward. But this was, you don't see Volkswagens like this anymore in the States. This was super low light, the Fuji XPro 1, and any of the Fujis are really good in low light, right? Would you say they're fabulous in low light? So this was in the museum, a torture museum, and it was so dark. I'm amazed that this picture came out. I think it was like ISO 25,000. Again, shooting in low light, it really worked out quite well. This was in Guanajuato, the museum of the mummies of Guanajuato. And this was a doctor who discovered there was in the 18th century, there was an outbreak of cholera, and the poor people were buried in slit trenches. And about 100 years later, the grave diggers tried to make some room, exhume the graves, and they found there was a high saline content in the soil, and it preserved the mummies really well. So it was part of the mummies of Guanajuato. Shot through glass with a polarizer, mummy head. Babies. cool stuff. This was National Geographic got in there and did a story in the 70s on the mummies of Guanajuato. And this was shot, this was some of the National Geographic stuff. So it's negatives and just a good close-up macro shot of the details. They were analyzing the bones, babies, more of these. So I'll spare you guys all this stuff. And this was another one of trying to get in the right spot to get the shot. Okay. All right, so enough of that. And I want to just show you guys just one more picture. These were, there were altars all over the place over Day of the Dead. And they call it, they would put ofertas, which were offerings to the deceased. And these were all over the place. It was just, if you ever go to Mexico, go during Day of the Dead. It's really an amazing celebration. Pretty cool. Okay, I want to show you guys a couple more shots, some examples. So these examples I'm going to show you are shot as they are out of the camera and then after doing a little bit of Snapseed. So here's a color shot. This is the best of the West. And here it is in black and white. Do you guys like it better in color or black and white? Black and white, yep, definitely. Okay, so this is Guanajuato. I believe it's Guanajuato. So it's color, right? And boy, I had the camera in black and white mode, but I had to shoot this in color. But I was very curious how it looked in black and white. So you're able to edit the photo and play around with it a little bit in black and white. Do you guys prefer it in black and white or color?
Color.
Yeah, color definitely does something to it. Color, and then using Snapseed and increasing the grain a little bit. Changing the photograph very dramatically. I think I like it better in color. Yeah. So this is my father. very backlit. This is a 101st uniform. He was acting up for me. And then this was modified in Snapseed. A lot of style put onto this. So, okay, photograph. Dad's expression works pretty good. But I think this just adds to it quite a bit. So this is a this is an app where you can put words. So I added poetry to a shot. What app? This app is called. Thanks for asking me what app that was. that was. Oh. I'm sorry. I think I deleted the app after I used it a couple of times. It was Typewriter. It was called. It was some kind of, it was called Typewriter of some sort. But any case, I'll get back. This is another heavily styled, this is using the grunge effect. I'll show you that in Snapseed in a second. Kind of adds an interesting grunge look. This is using point of focus very heavily. Playing with the saturation on this. Again, more saturation stuff. You had to shoot this guy. Playing with the saturation, adding a border to it. Playing with the structure. I'm really a huge fan of, look at this one. Okay, so here's a, how many guys have you shot? Okay, look at this. This is like the worst light to shoot in, right? It's got no direction to it, no great quality of light. Photograph was done, imported to Snapseed, and really pumped it up and saved the photograph tremendously. Yeah. Okay, so let's open up Snapseed and play with Snapseed. Oh, this is the farmer's hands. So. I posted this, I blog posted like right after it happened, but we found out about it, so that's the farmer's hands. But in his pocket, I stuck that Instax, and I'd love to know what happened to that. In my perfect world, that family has that photograph up on their hearth. Probably the jacket was thrown away, and that was the end of that Instax, and he never noticed it was there. Okay, all right, so let's go to Snapseed and do a little bit of workflow, do a little tour of Snapseed. Okay, so first thing we're going to do is we're going to open up an image. So I chose this image to work with. This is just a little bit of a test image. It's Italy. Scooters are all over the place, right? So you got to photograph a scooter. So this photograph is what I call it's a middle-of-the-road photograph, but we're going to play with it a little bit. So first thing I like to do when I open up the file is I want to do a little bit of a crop on it in case it's not perfect, and this one definitely needs a little bit of help with a crop. So we're going to go to the crop tool. And the crop tool is great. The crop tool lets you move things around, so you can adjust it the way you want. Or you can play with an aspect ratio. and the aspect ratio lets you go to square, so you can see how the image will look in square. But I think we're going to stick with the original, and we're going to crop it custom. So what I like to do is just draw the lines down a little bit. I got a little bit of a problem with that grating that's over there, so we're going to diminish it by cutting it in half. We're going to bring the back up a little bit, bring that down. Now, I'm pretty happy with that crop because I got those flowers in there and it contrasts nicely with the blue scooter. But if I hit the preview button, it actually shows me what I'm getting. So it shows me I'm pretty happy with that crop, and I think we're going to keep it.
Which is the preview button?
The preview button is down over here, bottom preview. Snapseed doesn't have many buttons, so experimenting with it will definitely help out. So now we're going to click apply, and it crops the photo the way that we like it. I'm not a huge cropper, but cropping definitely needs to happen sometimes. Okay, now take a look at this. Do you see this line here? See how that line is a little skewed? Actually, the whole picture is a little bit, the rotation, the orientation slightly off. So what we can do on that case is we're going to go to straighten. Now straighten, I can rotate the image left or right if I wanted to, but we don't want to do that. We just want to adjust it a little bit. So the way Snapseed works is it likes you to use, to change things, it likes you to use the screen. So I can go up or down by touching the screen to rotate it. And you'll notice it gives you these handy dandy guidelines. So when I do the rotation, I can just play with the guideline a little bit and adjust it. Now if I hit preview, so there's my change. And that's the way it was before, but now it's been straightened out. So I just straightened it out literally on the bottom. It tells me it's a small percentage, just enough to get it right. So I hit apply and we're good. Okay, next thing I'd like to do, I want to show you guys the tuned image. And okay, we're going to go to tune image. Now tune image has a menu that all these different items can be changed on it. So brightness, now normally if you guys are Photoshop people, you never touch brightness in Photoshop, right? But it's okay to play with brightness in Snapseed. So I'm going to go up and down to choose what I want to choose, but when I choose it, then I can go left to right and I can make the adjustment to the brightness. And it tells me up on top what the number is, and also down here on the bottom. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to brighten it up a little bit. Now, I'm a big fan of brightening things up because things will look good on your screen, but when you start transferring things to different devices, they get a little bit darker, and the internet makes things a little bit darker as well when you upgrade, when you start putting things on Facebook or to blogs. So I'd like to do a little bit of a brightness check. The next one is ambience. So what ambience does is ambience increases shadow detail. You can see how that changes dramatically. And what's fun with Snapseed is just to darkens it up a little bit, just play around so that it looks good on your eyes. And ambience, I'm just going to kick up a little bit. Okay. And then I'm going to go to contrast. And contrast, really, you can boost the contrast, lower it. It might be your style to boost it up a little bit. I'm just going to play with contrast a little bit, make it a little snappier. And then saturation. Saturation's a good one. Look at what we can do with saturation. Make those blues much stronger. Look at the pinks really exploded. Way too much at 100%. So what does George Bates say? Keep it simple. We're going to do a little bit of saturation. We're going to add to it. If you choose shadows, look at the shadows over here. And I can really brighten up the image by just playing with the shadows. I don't like to do that too much. I like to just add a little bit as a little tweak. And then warmth. So warmth right now, this photograph was probably taken around midday. It's not too warm, but look at how I can warm it up. Much nicer, huh? Actually, let's hit compare over here. So I just warmed it up a little bit. Let's compare it to what it was before. So there it was before I made the adjustment, after I made the adjustments. It's a nice noticeable difference warming it up a little bit. So tuning the image, you can go to that warm up. Now I'm going to hit cancel on the tune because I'm not going to tune up to what I just changed because we're going to do this. We're going to convert to black and white. All right, so let's go black and white. and now it turns the image to black and white. Over here we get brightness, we can play with contrast, and we can play with grain. So if you want to go for style, playing with grain is interesting. Look how I just totally grained it up, like we shot with Kodak Tri-X film or P3200. I can add a lot of grain to it. This is a good one for style, because could you imagine shooting, let's say you go to Rome and you shoot all the beautiful architecture, maybe play with the grain and really add a lot of drama to it by adding the grain. That's kind of interesting. Me, I like fine grain. I'm not a big grain guy. That's not my style. But again, if Laura and I were standing here and we shot the same Vespa, I could dramatically increase grain and change it tremendously. There's another effect that you've got some filters that you can play with, and the filters would increase contrast if you go with red, you go with orange, green for shooting people, changes everything dramatically. But we're gonna go neutral and not play with anything. Okay, so we're gonna convert it to black and white. We like that. Let's go to brightness. Let's give it a little bit of brightness. Let's go to contrast, make it a little bit contrastier, and we're gonna hit apply. Hitting apply in the back, processes it, it gives us our file. Okay, now we're gonna do the next two steps, and we're gonna play with one of the coolest filters that's in Snapseed. Are you guys ready? The drama filter. We all love drama. Haven't we had best friends that do a lot of drama? We grunt. Okay, let's add some drama, the best kind of drama. Okay, so drama has these, there's a button called style, and what I suggest you do is, once you choose a style, always apply that drama style to all your images so that your work looks very consistent. The Day of the Dead stuff, did you notice how consistent all those portraits were and all that work? I pretty much did the same treatments in Snapseed on each image. Took about a minute to edit each image to the point that I liked it. So I like drama number two. And drama number two just gives a punch to the picture. Let's go to compare. There's the original way. And look at drama number two. How do we like drama number two? Good. Pretty heavy. Filter strength is at around 90%. I kind of like drama around 30%. That's the original shot, and that's with drama. It's really cool. Drama is a wonderful filter. It can do so much. So playing with the different styles, that was drama one, and drama two is what I liked. There's a high key drama, and then there's a shadowy dark drama. So let's bring the filter strength down just a little bit. Let's compare. Big difference, huh? Now this image was tricky. I chose this one because it had that nice color effect going on. So I think that the image works in black and white and it works in color. I think color's a little more dramatic because of the flowers. So let's go back to style number two. And let's knock it down a little bit. Do the compare, looks good. Okay, we're gonna click apply. Okay, so we did drama. Now, this is a cool one. This is a great one. This is called selective adjust. Snapseed for free is pretty darn powerful. So we're gonna go to selective adjust. Now, selective adjust allows me to add a control point. So I'm gonna click add, and then I'm gonna go into a corner of the picture. So we'll go up on top of here. By squeezing or pinching, I can show the amount of adjustment that I'm gonna do. So I hit add, and I'm choosing the brightness control point. I can choose different contrast, saturation, or brightness. So we're gonna go to brightness. If I go in one direction, I make it darker. If I go in the other direction, I make it lighter. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go over to the brightness. I'm gonna add about 22% dark, which is the red. I'm gonna hit control over here, and I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna choose the size, go a little dark. I'm gonna add another control point down over here. Control the size of it, we'll go there. Make it a little bit darker. I'm gonna add another control point into this corner. Do you guys see what I'm doing here? What I've done is I've done a little vignette, made it a little darker in the corners. Now a strategic vignette is always good because a strategic vignette brings the viewer right into the image. To compare how it looks without it, there it was without, and that's with. So Snapseed gives you a second to look at it without the control points. This is called selective adjust. Selective adjust tool. So what I did pretty much with all the pictures for Day of the Dead, I darkened up the corners a little bit just to give a little vignette. Now here's where Photoshop and Nick works better. Photoshop works much better at this, because what it does is if you go too much on it, like let's adjust this one. If you go too much, it just makes it gray and it blocks up the shadows. That's no good. That looks awful. So I don't recommend going too high on that. But the other cool part is you can make selective adjusts. So let's look at this image. Look at the highlight over here. Might be a little bit too much, right? So we're gonna add a control point there, and then I can squeeze it. So I'm only adjusting that area that turned red. And then I can go and knock it down a little bit. See that? Got rid of my highlight nicely. So you can play around with that selective adjust. Now that was the brightness and contrast. Let's try, saturation is not going to work because we're in black and white mode. But if I want to saturate the color of the Vespa a little bit more or the flowers, I could do that here by going up and down brightness, contrast, and saturation. So that's selective adjust. Let's apply that selective adjust that we just did. Not bad for free software, huh, that you're doing on an iPad. It's a nice amount of control. The other thing too, editing with the iPad and playing with this is such a pleasure. Sitting down and opening up Photoshop and multiple windows and everything, it's very involved when you really work Photoshop. This is very organic and pleasant. I could be drinking a coffee in a cafe and be playing with my images. Okay, the last thing I like to do is apply actually, let me show you this one. This is pretty cool. Tilt shift. So in this picture, everything's in focus, the background and the Vespa. With the tilt shift, and watch how we just do it organically with it. I'm gonna lower it, I'm gonna make it a band, and I'm gonna let the Vespa be sharp. Make sure the whole Vespa is sharp. And we got the Vespa sharp and the background's out of focus. It's like we shot it with a 50mm 1.2 lens, or we shot it with something more intense. What I like about this is, remember we talked about over here being a little distracting? So I'm gonna turn it so that we have a band going up across the top, and I could do a stripe going across. I can make it a little bit wider so the whole Vespa's caught, but we get softness in the corners. Isn't that neat? This is the tilt shift. Now the cousin to tilt shift, do a little compare there. The cousin to tilt shift is the center focus. And center focus is just a circle. So you can see the circle there, and I can contract the circle, make it larger or smaller. So I could put the circle down here on the... So now just the Vespa got it. And area up on top is a little bit soft. And then I can control the blur strength, make it more blurry. So now it's really just the Vespa sharp. I can play with an inner brightness that's inside of the circle as well. And again, it always tells me on this graph on the bottom, which is really nice. Can change the size, make it very strong, make it weaker. Outer brightness, make the area outside brighter. Pretty cool. And then there's some presets they also give you that you can set up, like a vignette if you want to do a vignette on it. Makes similar to what I was doing with the selective adjust, but it's built into it. Pretty cool stuff. Now, let's say that I just want to do the vignette on the shot, but I don't want to just get the brightness going there. So I can go vignette, which works, but I can make the circle very large. Bring it up a little bit. Oh. And just vignette that way. Pretty cool stuff. Okay, so let's apply. We like everything that we're doing. The last step that I like to do is to put a frame around it. Now the frame is where you can go crazy, and I recommend don't go crazy. Keep it simple, KISS. So it gives me a choice of frames. There's an option over here. I can format, I can colorize it, don't do that. Click on this suitcase, which gives me all the frames. And I've got a series of high key frames and a series of low key frames. Low key meaning dark frames, high key meaning white frames. And then I get some crazy stuff like circular corners. Look at that, who remembers that? Film, a little film rebate edge going on there. I like, this one's a nice one. It's a little complicated, but this one's very simple, very thin line. So once I choose the frame I want, this is too much space. And also the frame does encroach on your picture. So when you're cropping, remember, if you do a very tight crop right here and you're gonna add a frame, you're probably going to get that cut into it. But once you choose your frame, you can then squeeze it and you can choose the size of your frame. So I like to go right up to the edge so it floats. I get a black background and it floats really nicely. The cool thing about the frame, I'm not a big fan of the frame when my destination was a photo book, but for putting images on a blog or on Facebook, the frame works really good because it makes the image pop out against the background of what's going on. So that's pretty much the tour of Snapseed. Let's save this picture. And I want to go back to my photos, which I've got organized very crazy. If we go to albums, that frame has been edited and it shows up in camera roll. So there's my pictures in the camera roll. Now what I could do is I can go edit and go back to camera roll. We're going to go select. I select that image. So that's been selected. And now I'm going to go add to, and we're going to add that to the, where's my test shots? So we'll put it in recent work and it goes into that folder. So now if I go back to folders, recent work, it's been added to the bottom of recent work. Now, what if I want to organize this and make it fit into, I want that picture to be first and not on the bottom. When you're under select, then you can move it around and change it. So let's put it by the other Vespa guy over here. Okay. Alrighty. This was a cool shot. Whoops.
Is that through iPad or something else?
This is through Photo and iPad, yeah. This is the iPad native software. Yeah, not adjusting it. Okay, so little Cyclone family. Pretty much that's the presentation. We'll take some questions and answer, but I just want to show you guys. Thank you very much.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.